Before we begin, if you have a cell phone, kindly remind you to either put it on vibrate or turn it off. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the same consolation we ourselves have received from God. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We join together in our congregational hymn On Eagle's Wings, and the words are printed in your bulletin.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom my trust, and I will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of my hand. The snares of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under God's wings, your refuge, with faithfulness your shield, and I will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of my hand. For to the angels God's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And I will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of my hand.
On behalf of myself and Christ Community Lutheran Church, bid you welcome. And to all of you, a great big thank you for coming and supporting the family during this time. We all know and have gotten to know Ellen in our past here, and we can say so long farewell with in good conscience and with great joy, because she was a marvelous person. And you're going to hear more about, well, you probably have a copy of the obit, but she cut a pretty wide swath. And we're grateful to God that she was a faithful servant and a good mom, grandma, great-grandma. Hot doggies, right? So So once again, thank you for your time, friends and members of Christ Community, for coming here today. Let us pray. O God of grace, God of glory, we remember before you today our sister Ellen, and we thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage here on earth. And Lord, in your boundless compassion, we ask that you'll console those who are mourning, that they will cast their sorrow on you, and that they may know the consolation of your love. And we pray also that you'll give us your aid to do this so that we may see in death the gate to eternal life, and that we may continue our own course on earth and do so in confidence until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us. And we pray this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Like I said, you have the obituary there, and but I'm going to read this because it's just marvelous. Ellen Christine Killam was born on May the 18th, 1921, in Auburn, California, to Einar and Seneva Berg. Following the births of her siblings, Evelyn, Mildred, and Raymond in San Francisco, the family also spent time in Auburn on a family farm with Einar's brother John and his wife Agnes, who was also Seneva's sister. I said that right? Seneva. Okay. I forgot to ask you for that exact pronunciation, so there you go. Times were hard during the Great Depression, but the families worked together to get by. Ellen remained frugal throughout her life and always valued hard work. Ellen made her first trip to Norway at the age of 9, traveling with her family across the Atlantic aboard the SS Bergensfjord. Ellen always treasured her Norwegian heritage and returned to Norway many times during her life. Ellen spoke Norwegian fluently, having learned as a child from her immigrant father and grandmother. She was often called on to translate for her grandmother, who was elderly when she immigrated and spoke little English. After graduating from San Francisco's Balboa High School in 1940, Ellen attended the University of California at Berkeley, where she received a degree in dental hygiene. Usually a four-year program, Ellen completed her degree in 3 years due to the outbreak of the Second World War. Ellen married Stanley Planchin in 1942, and they later settled near his parents in Oakley, California. Their daughter, Diane, was born in 1947, Carol in 1954, and Linda in 1956. Ellen worked for many years at Antioch Dental Group in Antioch, California, as a dental hygienist, and was very involved with the American Dental Hygienist Association. Ellen was also a lifelong member of the Sons of Norway and was recognized in 2018 for 75 years of membership. Additionally, Ellen was a charter member of the Daughters of Norway, Theofoss Lodge, and founded in 2004 in Chimicum? Hot doggies. Washington. After her first marriage ended, Ellen retired and became an active member of the Champion Mobile Wheelers RV Club. She traveled all over the United States and even into Mexico with her RV friends. She also enjoyed world travel, riding a camel in Egypt and backpacking in New Zealand. Lebanon, Turkey, Israel, Fiji, New Zealand, Canada, Mexico, England, France, Norway, Sweden, and Denmark were among the countries that she visited. And as I was told, every country except South America. Ellen was active in her church, Christ Community Lutheran Church in Lebanon, Oregon. And while she lived in California, she was a longtime member of the Covenant Women organization. She volunteered for leadership positions in all the organizations that she belonged to, including secretary and treasurer, as well as cultural programs chairperson. When her children were young, Ellen served as a 4-H leader, teaching children sewing, cooking, and food preservation. Ellen was an avid sewer and gardener, a cat lover, and a caregiver. She provided caregiving for her parents and other family members, as well as all three of her daughters when they needed help following medical emergencies and the births of their children. In her late 70s, Ellen was reunited with a friend from high school and rekindled a romance. Ellen and Frank Killam were married in 1998 in Brentwood, California, and later moved to Frank's hometown of Port Townsend, Washington. Frank passed away in 2004, and soon after, Ellen settled in Lebanon, Oregon to be closer to her family. Ellen especially loved children and was delighted to have five of her seven great-grandchildren living close by. Ellen is survived by her daughters, Diane, husband John Lovejoy, Carol Pinkin, and Linda with husband Vince Sino. Her grandchildren, James, Annie, wife Annie Lovejoy, Claire, husband Jacob Lundberg, Daniel and wife Charlotte Lovejoy, Michael Sino and Elizabeth Sino, and seven great-grandchildren. She was preceded in death by her husband Frank, her sister Evelyn, and her brother Raymond. And may God bless certainly our memories thus far as we've been shared for Ellen Killam. Now I have one in particular, memories, and this is from Claire. And she writes, as a child, I believed I had the best grandparents in the whole world. My dad's parents and my Nana Ellen were just the best. Nana made perfect fried eggs. This was very important to a four-year-old. We both hated runny yolks, and breakfast at Nana's was always going to be good. Nana's house was like a cave in the wonders of Aladdin. It seemed like she had the coolest stuff, toys to play with, plenty of paper and pencils to draw with, children's books to read, and she was happy to read aloud until she was hoarse. One of the children's books was even in Norwegian. So did you learn some Norwegian while you're doing it? Lite grann, right? Lite grann. Nana had a small RV that she drove everywhere. When I was older, she took me on a few road trips, just the two of us. I learned how to read maps and loved to be the official navigator on our trips. When I was a freshman in college in Washington, D.C., she came out to visit me. One of my roommates stayed with a friend and let Nana have her bed. Everyone got a kick out of having a grandma in their midst, eating in the dining hall with me while I was in class, she'd go sightseeing, visiting museums and the monuments. As an adult, I struggled to get pregnant, and she shared with me how she too had pregnancy issues. Her support and encouragement was very meaningful to me. Her delight in her great-grandchildren was precious to me, and I'm grateful they had a chance to know her. Thank you, Claire. Linda, did you want to try? Okay.
You can, say,
why don't you come on up here? That way you have something to lean on.
Something to hide behind?
Sure.
Okay. I just wanted to say, I'm so blessed to have had Mom for 99 years. She was a very accomplished woman, but she would always say, oh, I'm not any good at that. But she was good at so many things. She was the daughter of immigrant farmers and a house painter, but yet she attended college on work study at a time when it wasn't the typical thing for a young woman to do. She took risks and had a fearless approach to life. I thought that was normal growing up, and I didn't realize how precious that was because she encouraged us to explore our dreams and to have the courage to get out and try and to fail sometimes, because that's okay. You just need to find a different approach and keep going. And she was always there. I was trying to explain to my family, you know, she wasn't somebody who would dive in and rescue you unless you asked for help. She taught us to be strong and independent like she was. The most important thing Mom taught me was what unconditional love looks like, because I was on the receiving end, and I am going to be forever grateful for that. Thank you all for coming.
Thanks, Linda. And incidentally, we do have some music for the next hymn that we're going to be singing in a little bit, Children of the Heavenly Father, and it's Swedish. And what I thought we'd do is we'd sing the first four verses in English, the last two in Swedish. Like Linda said, if we just absolutely destroy the Swedish language when you're doing it, that's okay. We wouldn't know the difference anyway. And I'm sure that Ellen doesn't care. Okay, well, let's have a prayer. Heavenly Father, gracious God, you are indeed a marvelous, wonderful God. And we thank you that as you grace us with your presence moment by moment, we are overwhelmed by the ways in which you love us and you keep your promises. And so when you have made us as people of memory, you remind us that you are God of memory, that you never forgot your people, not once. You became extremely upset with them many times, but yet you raised up a remnant. You never, ever forgot them. And so it is with us, Lord, as we are remembering Ellen. You remembered her, and she knew you. And so at this time, your grace has brought her into your presence and shown her that you and truly, for sure, remembered her and brought her into your kingdom. And may that be for us too, Heavenly Father, that we will remember you as you have first remembered us. You did so through your Son, Jesus. It's because your wonderful love and Jesus' sacrifice on the cross that we are able to go on with our memories and give you praise, honor, glory, and thanksgiving for the many times, the many people that we are grateful to you for experiencing their lives and how they have enriched ours. And these folks have been the kind of folks they have been because it's the way that you made them. They understood your compassion, they understood your love. Many times, even in the midst of that understanding, not really understanding, but having faith. Faith that they would one day know all things, not through a mirror dimly, but clear, face to face. So I pray, Heavenly Father, right now that you'll bless the memories that have been shared. There's many more, I'm sure, that we have in our hearts. And I pray that the family members, friends, will share stories with them about Ellen. And perhaps, Lord, you will make one of those stories a great impact upon one of those folks that hear it. And they can rejoice in the story that they're in the faithfulness that you have had for her and now in eternity have made that complete. So gracious God, we pray for your blessing as we come to you in faith and trusting in your mercy. Hear our prayer for Jesus' sake. Amen. Please join with me in the reading of the 23rd Psalm, and that's on page 2 of your bulletin. And together, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The scripture passages, the first one from the 14th chapter of the Gospel, the first Corinthians chapter 13. I'll get it spit out eventually here. These are familiar words, and on a day like this, I think they take on even more of an importance and have a deeper meaning. where Paul writes, "If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, but the greatest of these is love." And then from the Gospel of John in chapter 14. Jesus says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where we are going, and how can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." This is the Gospel of our Lord. Dear family, friends in Christ, may God's grace and peace be to you. From the one who is and who was and who is to come, he's our Savior, Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. We've heard much about Ellen and how she carved out a life amongst family and friends, among many acquaintances, her church, service clubs, you name it, she was a part of it. She drove through it, she accomplished it, chewed it up, spit it out, and got on with it. We've heard how she was a daughter of a Norwegian immigrant and married a farm girl from the Palouse area. Now here you have a couple of things that get together, and that is an immigrant that is forsaking everything and going to somewhere that they've never known, beginning a new life that perhaps they're extremely nervous or have no clue what it's going to be. And they are finding ways of making it work. Tenacity of those folks, and some of my relatives were immigrants from Germany. And we know the work ethic that they came with, and so they were able to carve out a living for themselves. We find in Ellen someone who, when she invested herself in something, she invested her entire self. She didn't hold back, and it was the same way as she was part of the church. Now, when I came here 6 years ago, Ellen still was having the macular degeneration progressing quite heavily. But as I got to know her, one of the things I discovered was that she never quit on anything, and she was not, as she told me, I'm not stopping reading. I'm going to keep reading. And she got that machine so that she was able to do so. Now, with some folks, that might have been enough just to say, well, I'm not going to deal with this. I'm just going to let it go. I don't need to read anymore anyway. But for Ellen, as she expressed, her ability to read, and where she couldn't go, she could read about and explore, was really important to her. Keeping up with the newest things, you know, she didn't get into computers or anything like that, but she understood an awful lot about communication with people. And with her compassion, she found a place in her own society, within her family, within her church, that was one of caregiving. And she had a presence that was really kind of, you know, in a way, calming. She was very unassuming. She never called attention to herself. And there were times when she was almost like apologizing for taking up space. You know, it was just her nature. But with the things that you have put in her obituary, you can see how she was able to focus. And she did one thing, and she got good at it, and then she was ready to try another challenge. I thought it was fascinating that she would travel so much on her own. That RV, and of course you got to be navigator, and I was also told that she was one that when you traveled you did it her way, and you know, I suppose that's a good thing. You know, otherwise for a novice navigator, it could have been a real adventure if she didn't have it her way, I suppose. But she was adventurous, and that also informed the kind of person that she was and how she developed her character. And so we have all these things, the willingness to try different things, the willingness to read and to experience and all that. You know, one of the things that really hit me when I was reading these memories and the things that you had shared with me is that, and also your choosing of the scriptures, for Paul's letter to the 1 Corinthians in chapter 13, one of the things that you discover as you learn about Ellen is that her compassion, her ability and her skills to care for people, you could take them right out of chapter 13 of Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. It's all about love. And it wasn't that she was able just to pull this together on her own. She was one who depended upon Jesus to inform her and to help her, to encourage her, to remind her that she is loved. And the big thing is that she believed that Jesus went to the cross for her, died for her sins. She was forgiven, redeemed, and she had a new life in Christ. And she was able to express her life out of that in her service to Jesus and to her friends, her family, other acquaintances, and I saw that in Ellen, one who, and then didn't expect to be recognized for it. She was the kind that wanted to be off in a corner someplace, but she'd peek out every so often just to do her thing, and then, you know, slowly recede back. And I was always grateful for that. You know, just, she didn't do a whole lot. She always sat over there, and but she was quiet. But she was a presence. You knew that she walked with Jesus. I think one of the things that Ellen would probably tell us on a day like this is death is not extinguishing the light from the Christian. Rather, it is putting out the lamp because the dawn has come. I think she lived in that way, and that no matter what day it was, it was a new day. It was a way in which she was planning for her death. You know, for her, death was always right there, and it should be for all of us, in fact. The 18th century Bible commentary, Matthew Henry, said that for the believer, Death means entering into the glorious presence of Christ. And he expressed this confidence in words that he hoped would be read after his death by anyone who might unduly mourn his passing. Here's what he wrote. Would you like to know where I am? I am at home in my Father's house, in the mansions prepared for me here. I am where I want to be, no longer on the stormy sea, but in God's safe, quiet harbor. My sowing time is done, and I am reaping. Joy, my joy, is as the joy of harvest. Would you like to know what I am doing? I see God. Not as through a glass darkly, but face to face. I am engaged in the sweet enjoyment of my precious Redeemer. I am singing hallelujahs to him who sits upon the throne, and I am constantly praising him. Would you know what blessed company I keep? It is better than the best on earth. Here are the holy angels and the spirits of just men made perfect. I am with many of my old acquaintances with whom I worked and prayed and who have come here before me. Lastly, would you know how long this will continue? It is a dawn that never fades. After millions and millions of ages, it will be as fresh as it is now. Therefore, weep not for me. Well, we all know that that's easier said than done, weep not for me. In fact, weeping is natural and it ought to happen. But we ought not get stuck in our mourning. We need to be able to move beyond it and to celebrate Ellen's life or anyone else's life that we say goodbye to on this earth. So when we weep, we don't weep as people who have no hope. We weep as people who miss the person, but celebrate the person's destiny, their eternal salvation. Because if we're not doing those kinds of things, we're not preparing at all. We're preparing for something good, but it doesn't quite happen because the preparation wasn't complete. In Deuteronomy chapter 32 and verse 29, we hear, "Oh, that they were wise," talking about the children of Israel, who understood this, "that they would consider their latter end." So all of us need to make those specific plans for our departure from this life. And if we don't, we can be left in a predicament similar to a young man who became stranded in an Alaskan wilderness. His adventure began in the spring of 1981 when he was flown into the desolate North Country to photograph natural beauty and the mysteries of the tundra. He had photo equipment, 500 rolls of film, that was back a ways, several firearms, and 1,400 pounds of provisions. As the months passed, the entries in his diary, which at first detailed his wonder and fascination with the wildlife around him, turned into a pathetic record of a nightmare. In August, he wrote, "I think I should have used more foresight about arranging my departure. I'll soon find out." He waited and waited, but no one came to his rescue. In November, he died in a nameless valley by a nameless lake 225 miles northeast of Fairbanks. An investigation revealed that he had carefully mapped out his venture, but had made no provision to be flown out of the area. In that 32nd chapter, Deuteronomy, we read that the Israelites made a similar mistake. For a while, they had all they needed, but it soon became obvious that they had given no thought to the outcome of worshiping false gods and living for their own enjoyment. They failed to consider their latter end. So, like Ellen, have we ourselves thought about our exit from this life? The last thing, the last bit of preparation when we cross that threshold, which takes only that much time. Trusting Christ as our Savior and living for Him each day is the only way to be sure we have prepared for our departure. And so that is what we need to do, as Ellen did, and that is prepare for her last day. And she made it to 99. And I'm sure every year she was wondering, is this going to be the last one? Each and every day, is this going to be my last one? Each and every moment, Is this going to be my last one? You know, maybe we ourselves haven't asked that question, but maybe we ought to be asking that question, because each one of us is only a heartbeat away from dying. And so what have our preparations been? In the 14th chapter of John, we have Jesus telling his disciples, I'm going away and I'm going to prepare a place for you. And I'm really going to do this because if I wasn't going to, I wouldn't have told you that. He says, there's a whole bunch of rooms in my Father's house, and I'm going to have one just for you. So when I come back, I'm going to take you to be with me, where I am, and that is in heaven. But we have good old Thomas, who is probably one of the few honest ones amongst the disciples, and saying, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? Beautiful opportunity for Jesus to step in and say, ha-ha, I am the way, the truth, and life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Nothing else, no one else, Jesus alone. And he showed just how much he loved them and was able to carry that promise out when he went to the cross. And he did that not just for a few disciples, not for a few learned men and women, rather for all people. And so when we hear that, is that part and parcel? Is that the foundation upon which we build our future, upon which we are making our preparations, believing that Jesus is the only way, and then making the plans to follow that path? If we don't, as they say, we in a heap of trouble, Jackson. I think that Ellen, probably just before she took her last breath, would have been thinking something like John Wesley did just before he died in his 88th year. He sat up. He looked at his loved ones who were weeping at his bedside and said, best of all, God is with us. And you know how true that is? God is with us now. God is with us when we go from here to be with him in heaven. And so with all the things that Ellen was able to accomplish, all she did was part of what she did to express what she had as a relationship with Jesus. And that's what gave her empowerment. That's what gave her the compassion and the love. And that is why she could be a good mom, she could be a good grandma, good mother, and great grandma. And think about the triplets here, you know. You remember great-grandma? And she was pretty cool, you know. I bet you sat on her lap many times, didn't you? Huh? And you probably heard a lot of stories, too. Did you ever tell her a story? Yeah, I bet you did. And it was pretty cool, you know. You got to share those things. And one of the best things that she would have shared with you is the story about Jesus and his love. So keep remembering that. Each and every one of us, keep remembering that. Because that's the legacy that Ellen leaves behind for each and every one of us. Trust in God, trust also in Jesus, because there is a place for us. Amen. Who would like to have a sheet of paper that has the Swedish words? I think we have a few left over back there. So, David? Can you? Oh, he didn't catch me. Would you like to look, Miss Debbie? There should be some sheets on where the bulletins were, and it has "Children of the Heavenly Father," a Swedish hymn, and it has words that are in English and in Swedish. We'll see what we can do with those. It's a beautiful hymn. Okay, who would like to have one? It's like Linda and I said, you know, we may as well kill the Swedish language right along with us. It's good.
I don't know.
Now, what you'll need to do is the last two verses we're gonna try in Swedish, but you need to pay attention to the verses that are in here, okay? Until you've sung these four, then you go to the last two on the Swedish ones. Is that pretty clear? Okay, let's try it. Children of the Heavenly Father, safely in His bosom gather. Nestling bird nor star in heaven, such a refuge e'er was given. God His own doth tend and nourish, in His holy courts they flourish. From all evil things He spares them, in His mighty arms He bears them. Neither life nor death shall ever from the Lord His children sever. Unto them His grace He showeth, and their sorrows all He knoweth. Though He giveth or He taketh, God His children ne'er forsaketh. His the loving purpose solely, to preserve them pure and holy. Glaudetatulishlakara, Jahus gud skal dibefara, for hans fysia musti alla, findet is your den falla. Vaden tar hos at han giver, samme fader han forbiver, og hans møl hår blottet henne, herrens navn av all alene. Let us pray. Gracious God, loving Lord, for your presence with us, we thank you. And Lord, for all the memories that we have of Ellen, for the memories that we have of you, and realizing that you remember us, we thank you. For in all these things, it gives us courage and strength to move through these days, and for the family that they will be experiencing the firsts of their lives without Ellen in their life. And I ask you, Lord, that you'll bless them. Bless them with joy as they come to those places, the celebrations, the special occasions, and to give you thanks for the gift that Ellen was to them. And for the many stories that they have, the many experiences that they had, the joy of being together as family, having the little ones around as well as the oldsters. We pray, Lord, that as you have done all things for us, that we might take from you the grace that you bestowed upon us and to express that to others. That we will share with others the wonderful good news that you, our Savior Jesus, is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and is reaching out to each and every person with the invitation to come and to believe, to remember and to take to heart that you, Jesus, are the way, the truth, and the life, and that no one comes to the Father except through you. Grant, Lord, that we will indeed listen and believe, and to follow and to do. Do as your Son Jesus does. He works through us through the power of your Holy Spirit. And help us to be grateful. Grateful for the days that we have. Grateful for the days that we pray we will have. And grateful for the people that we've had in our lives. Gracious God, we pray for comfort for the family. We pray that you will love them, hold them up, and give them joy in all things. So I ask this, gracious God, in Jesus' name, for he is the one who continues to teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, those who die in the Lord still live with you in joy and blessedness. We give you great thanks for the grace that you have bestowed upon your servants who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labors, as does your servant Ellen. May we, with all who have died in the true faith, have perfect fulfillment and joy in your eternal and everlasting glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give to you his eternal peace. Amen. Would you please stand as you're able, and we will sing our last hymn, How Great Thou Art. My God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the glades I wander, I hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art.
great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Now let us go forth in peace in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.